Hi, I'm Rebecca Finneran with Michigan State University Extension. Pollinators are essential to our environment and they're uniquely connected to our food supply. Bees, flies, butterflies, moths, and even beetles are all great pollinators.
Hi, I'm Abby Saith, also with MSU Extension. So what's the buzz about pollinators? Why are they getting so much media attention? And what do they do in our home landscapes? Pollinators are seeking pollen and nectar, and in doing that, they are responsible for pollinating more than 85% of the world's flowers and crops. This small but mighty group is responsible for seeds and fruits that humans, songbirds, and even mammals consume.
Bees are dying at an alarming rate due to losses of flowers for food and habitat. When you consider how much our everyday life depends on a healthy bee population and pollinators, gardeners start to wonder what they can do to make a difference in the pollinator habitat.
No matter how large or small, your efforts to conserve pollinators will make a difference. Smart gardeners are taking a huge step forward in pollinator conservation by learning more about their habitat needs and food sources, and how to adjust our gardening practices to be more pollinator friendly.
You might think first of honeybees when it comes to pollinators. We also have over 450 species of bees that live right here in Michigan, and they could be in your backyard. Native bees come in many shapes and sizes, but pound for pound, they do a lot of work.
Pollinators such as bees and butterflies can be encouraged to take up residence in your garden by simply adjusting a few of your normal gardening routines. By incorporating pollinator-friendly plants and reducing pesticide and other chemical applications, these hard-working creatures will naturally move in to provide numerous benefits in terms of pest control and pollination. There are a variety of ways you can make your landscape an inviting sanctuary for bees and beneficial insects.
Bees need a continual source of nectar and pollen through the season. Try to be very intentional about your plant choices so that you're choosing plants that bloom from early spring through the summer months and then well into fall. Try to include a wide range of flowering plants, including natives. They might be annuals, perennials, bulbs, trees, and shrubs. Any of these that are known to support pollinator health.
Early spring blooming plants such as bulbs, fruit trees, and even ground covers provide much needed resources for small bees with early foraging habits. There are many options for plants that provide nectar and pollen during the mid-season landscape. This will attract many different types of bees. Make sure you choose many different sizes and shapes of flowers, so there is something out there for every type of bee. Fall blooming trees and shrubs, like the Seven Sun tree, provide floral resources for those late season pollinators like bumblebees that are getting ready to overwinter. Fall blooming trees and shrubs, such as panicle hydrangeas, provide nectar and pollen for late foragers. Annual salvia, allium, and sedum perform right up until frost, attracting pollinators to their sweet nectar.
Annuals such as pentas, lantana, zinnia, tithonia, and sunflowers, and even herbs such as borage, make absolutely great pollinator plants. Some of the best perennials in the garden include things like catmint and allium, and even sneezeweed, also known as helenium. Trees and shrubs such as horse chestnut and panicle hydrangea and seven sunflower can make great pollinator plants as well. Even lawn weeds like clover and dandelion make excellent pollinator plants. Pollinator plants can be easily used in containers as well, like this butterfly bush. Perennials, annuals, and even woody plants can be used in a container and then just nestled right back into your garden in the fall.
Bees will forage on hundreds of types of flowering plants, and they also see flowers differently than we do because of their ability to see the ultraviolet spectrum along with the color spectrum that we see. Bees can see patterns, colors, and markings that enable the insect to pilot their way directly to the pollen source. A majority of native bee species nest in the ground. This group, including sweat bees, mining bees, and bumblebees, live in undisturbed areas of soil along pathways or burrows that have been previously occupied by other creatures. The soil they prefer varies by the type of bee, but if you leave some patches of untreated, undisturbed earth, such as behind a garden shed or along a little used path, bees will find it and make themselves a home. Bare patches of soil don't need to be unsightly and can be simple, small, and tucked away from view. If you encourage pollinators to make their nests in out-of-the-way places, they're also less likely to come into contact with humans.
Bee hotels like this one here at the MSU Extension Grand Ideas Garden have become very popular in pollinator gardens. The clever design allows cubby holes for different sized paper tubes, drilled boxes, and even bundles of sticks to attract a wide variety of cavity nesting bees. Lots of other ideas can be found online to make simple bee hotels using blocks of wood or PVC pipe with cardboard tubes.
Providing floral resources and habitat is just the first step towards inviting pollinators to your landscape. It is important to pay attention to chemicals used in and around the gardens. Never spray chemicals when flowers are present, and be wary about how your sprays may move off target. Always read the manufacturer's instructions and choose products that are least toxic to bees. Do not spray trees, shrubs, and garden plants while they are in bloom, and watch for drift to unintended locations. Mow lawns that have clover and dandelions blooming before a chemical application to be sure a foraging bee will not be affected.
Also, some annuals and perennials can be encouraged to rebloom during the summer with pruning or routine deadheading. Some of our old garden favorites, such as coral bells, have been bred to bloom throughout the whole season. Providing a wide range of bloom sizes and shapes will also encourage pollinators regardless of their size. Tubular-shaped flowers with an extended petal, such as foxglove or perennial salvia, allow bees to alight and then enter the bloom. Open flowers with flat umbels, like sunflower, provide resources to many types of pollinators and insects. While you may be deadheading some plants to encourage rebloom, you may want to hold off on some other plants. Hosta stalks will provide nectar for a long bloom period, even though they may be considered unsightly in the garden. Leaving a stalk on the last bloom that opens may provide a nice lunch for a foraging bee. No matter how large or small, even in the tiniest space in your home landscape, you can invite pollinators to come live and thrive. By planning now to incorporate annuals, trees, and shrubs, and even vines into your landscape, you'll be making a better habitat for pollinators at home. For more information on how you can be a smart gardener for pollinators, visit us online.